Welcome back to my channel. Today's video is going to be another story time for you guys. So this video is going to be a story time about how a call led me to the ER. And get your snacks, get your pizza, get your Cheetos, because we're about to get into another story time. Most of you guys know I promote alcohol a lot all over my social medias. I do show that I go out and I drink. I even have Fuck It Up Fridays on my channel. And it's not necessarily that I'm trying to promote people to drink. It's just I do go out and I have fun, and people always ask, like, what do I drink? So I started sharing it with you guys. But about 5 years ago, because I'm 26 now, I'm freaking old, but I'm 26 years old now. And when I first turned 21, I started drinking. And surprise, surprise, believe it or not, being in a Latina family, I actually waited till I was 21 years old to start drinking. And it wasn't necessarily because I wasn't allowed, because I mean, alcohol has always been around my family. My dad, you know, he's your typical Mexican man, drinks a lot of beer. I just personally didn't really like alcohol back then. When I was younger, I was never, you know, a drinker. I never thought about, like, oh, let's take a shot. Like I said, I grew up very sheltered, very traditional Mexican mom. I wasn't really allowed to go out. I didn't have very many friends, so it's not like I really had an influence to go out and party with anybody, because I was just kind of at home all the time with my sister and my my siblings, you know. When I first started going out, it was about 19, 20 years old, and the only reason I was allowed to go out was because I was with my sister, Viv, which is the person that you guys always see on my vlogs. And Viviana, I was basically her DD. So she would go, and she would go out with her friends, and I would drive them. So I was the DD for almost 2 years. I would go get in with her ID and basically just drive them back, you know, because she wanted to go out and drink, and I told her, like, I don't care. At that point, I didn't need to drink to have fun, so I was like, whatever, I don't care. I'll just go out with you and your friends, and I'll drive you guys back. So that was me for, like, the first 2 years of me going out. And let me tell you, I used to deal with a lot of drunk people, and I used to just, like, die of laughter. I'm a very patient person when it comes to drunk people around me. Like, I'm always the one that's trying to, like, take care of everybody, make sure everybody's okay, and recording. I always make sure that I record everything. Do you know how many videos I have of people on my phone? Like, a lot of people on my phone. But that was just me, you know. So I finally turned 21. My sister was waiting forever for me to finally turn the big 21, and we went all out. By all out, I mean we went all out. She took me to Miami, she took me to Vegas, and then when we arrived from Vegas that weekend after, we went to Sacramento. I think it was, yeah, Sacramento. She got me a limo. We all went out, had VIP, and I completely blacked out for the first time that weekend. So that weekend was my actual 21st birthday, and I got so belligerently drunk that I was dead weight. If you drink, you know what dead weight is, when you're like completely gone and you're just like hanging, like, with no life. Okay, so there's pictures of, like, Lisa's and my sister basically dragging me out of the club on my 21st birthday. So that's just rules, you know, like, on your 21st birthday, everybody should not remember their 21st. That's kind of like how I always thought about it, and I felt like it was accomplished. So Lisa's and I had been dating for about 2 weeks at that point. Not dating, but actually going out, boyfriend and girlfriend. And I kind of just went nuts. I was just drinking all the time. Like, I was drinking all the time. And I feel like it was because I never drank before. So finally, I was 21. I could order a drink everywhere and anywhere, and nobody was going to question it. And I was just enjoying the feeling, you know. I did like being, you know, buzzed and hanging out with my friends, and it was a cool feeling, you know. But I was drinking to the point where I was drinking Tuesdays, Taco Tuesday, Thursday, Thirsty Thursday, Fridays, Saturdays, sometimes even Sundays. Like, I was drinking Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, drunk, like getting drunk all the time. I can tell you guys stories of times that Ulises had to, like, carry me out of El Torito's on Taco Tuesdays because I was drunk. you know? And it's not something that I'm like proud of, like, oh my God, I was like a hot mess, because that wasn't the case. I just feel like I turned 21. I felt like I was so free. Like, I just wanted to drink and go out and party and have fun, because I waited so long. I was never like a party girl. Like, sometimes I hear people, they're like, I've been partying since I was 14 years old. I used to go to house parties. I wasn't allowed to go anywhere growing up. I wasn't allowed to even spend the night at my best friend's house. I wasn't allowed to go anywhere. My mom was not, like, if I wanted to go to the mall or the movies, it had to be like in the day. I was not allowed to go past like 6 o'clock. If I wanted to go to a late movie, it was impossible. So when I finally turned 21, it was like I was kind of free, you know? So then to add on top of me finally turning 21, I ended up moving out with one of my really good friends, and her name was Bianca. And we decided to move out to the Bay Area. I was about to turn 22, and we moved to the Bay Area. That was like the literally end of like my drinking life, okay? Because when I moved with Bianca, we were now in the city, so we would go up to San Francisco, go get drunk. We had our own apartment, so sometimes on the weekends, like Fridays and Saturdays, our friends would come over on the weekends and we would have parties and just drink. Like, we had our own little bar. Me and Bianca customized our own little like bar area where we had hella liquor, and like we were just living the party life, you know? And it was so different, completely out of what I was raised to do, you know? Because being in a traditional family, like, you're raised to basically grow up and leave your parents' house until you get married and blah 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 blah, blah, you know? My mom allowed me to basically move out because it was for my job. I had got promotion, so it was only going to be temporary. She knew that I would be back and moving in with her, you know? So that lasted for about 6 months of me living with her and us just kind of going out and partying. So this is where, back when I was introducing you guys to Miguel, when I keep telling him that the day that I met him was the day that he sent me to the ER. So I told Lisa, like, hey, tell Miguel if he wants to come over, we're going to have a party. So then Miguel was like, yeah, of course, I'm down, let's go. And they drove up all the way to the Bay Area where I live and where we all lived. It's about an hour and a half to drive up, but we had our own apartment, so they knew that they could crash there. So he was like, yeah, I'm down. So he decides to bring Jaeger. I was only a vodka drinker. I only drank like Ciroc, Grey Goose. That was all I would drink. Like, vodka was my shit, you know? And he decides to bring Jaeger, and I had never ever drank Jaeger before in my life. So I was like, okay, yeah, let's turn up. Like, I don't care, you know, when you're in that moment, you feel so bossy. You're just like, yeah, I'll take this shot. Yeah, I'll take that shot. And by that point, I was still like learning how to drink. You know what I mean? Like, I didn't know what my level was. I was just getting drunk to get drunk. I was just drinking. And we were taking Jaeger shots. We were just, to be honest, I don't even remember like what the hell we were drinking. I know I was mixing like Smirnoff vodka and like Grey Goose and Ciroc and tequila and Jaeger, and I was just mixing everything. But we ended up finishing the whole Jaeger bottle, and we all got drunk. Everybody got drunk to the point where we all just kind of slept off and blacked out and ended up in our own rooms, right? So Lisa spent the night. I was there. I wake up, and I wake up fine. I wake up like with a hangover, like I always do. And I was kind of like jittery. Like, if you guys know what jittery is, like when you shake, you know, I naturally shake, my hands shake a lot, but this time I was shaking a lot. Like, I was just very jittery, had a huge headache. I felt like I was gonna throw up. My stomach was upset, like your typical hangover, right? So I was like, oh my God, I'm so hungover. So at this time, I was drinking like teas, like the tummy teas, you know, like the ones, the tea tummy teas that we promote and stuff. So I was actually drinking the tummy teas. So I decided to drink one right after I woke up, and I drank some water, and apparently not thinking that the tummy tea was gonna get me more like jittery, because it's gonna give you energy, it ended up freaking me up so bad that I was like shaking so bad, okay? Like, I was like, oh my God, I don't know what's wrong with me. I was just feeling like really shaky. So I end up telling Elisa, like, let's just go to the gym. Let's go to the gym. I need to, like, sweat this hangover off. Bad idea when you're hungover, you're dehydrated, and you should not be drinking, you know, and then going to the gym. So that was a bad idea. Elisa was like, yeah, let's just go sweat it off. So we're at the gym. I come back, and I run to the bathroom. When I run to the bathroom, I'm just throwing up. I'm, like, feeling, like, cramps on my stomach. And I'm like, dude, what is going on with my system? Why am I freaking out? You know, like, oh, my goodness. So then I told Elisa, like, let me just get ready so we can come up to my mom's house. So we were going to drive up to Stockton. This was on a Saturday. We were going to drive up to Stockton for Sunday. And I told him, like, let me just get ready so we can drive up. So I'm, like, straightening my hair and trying to get ready. And I feel like my body is just hot. And I feel like I'm going to pass out. I was just feeling, like, complete garbage. Like, I felt like I was dying. Okay? So I'm, like, driving home. We get in the car. We're driving home. And I experienced my very, very first panic attack. And if any of you guys have anxiety or have ever had a panic attack, you feel like you're dying. Like, you seriously feel like the world is just shutting out on you. Like, you feel like it's just you and pause, and everybody's just, like, living their lives, and you're just kind of, like, paused. It's like the weirdest feeling. But I experienced my very first panic attack, and I just remember me looking at Elisa's, and I started crying. I think this is probably, like, the second time Elisa's had ever seen me cry. The first time was when I moved out and I cried to my mom, and then the second time, I think this is the second time I actually cried to him, and I was like hyperventilating. I was like, oh my god, like, I felt like I couldn't breathe. I was like, I feel like shit. I was like, what's going on? I started shaking, and then he's trying to, like, stuff a banana down my throat. And I was feeling nauseous. I was like, I can't eat. I this is not the business. I don't know what's going on with me. So he was like, what do you want to do? I was like, I don't know. I'm freaking out. Like, I don't know what's wrong with me. So then we end up driving to the ER, and I'm in the emergency room, and I'm, like, freaking out. I'm, like, scared out of my mind. I'm still throwing up. So then when I throw up this next time, I was throwing up clear, like, mucus with, like, blood. Okay, so I'm like, oh my god, I'm dying. Like, the last thing you want to feel is, like, blood coming out of your body, because it's like you're bleeding internally. Like, my thought was like, I'm gonna die right now. Like, this is not happening right now. I cannot believe that I'm dying, you know. So I felt like shit. I told the doctor, like, this is what's going on. He basically was like, sweetie, you just experienced your first panic attack. And I was like, no, like, I'm dying. Like, fix me. I'm dying. Give me medicine. Tell me what's wrong with me. They put me on IV because they were like, you're very dehydrated. And then when I told him I was throwing up blood, he's like, if you have alcohol poisoning, you're basically going to be like this for the next couple of days. And I was like, what do you mean? I was like, what do you mean that I'm going to be feeling like this? I'm like, no, like, there's something more, you know? So I was thinking the complete worst, but he ruled it out as, you know, I experienced my first panic attack and I was having, like, a mild alcohol poisoning. So I was like, how is this possible? You know, I didn't think things like this happened. Like, I just thought, like, we're having fun. Like, you don't just get alcohol poisoning. You're not thinking about, like, how bad it is for you. It really is. So for the next couple of days, I decided to not go to work. I was working in the Bay Area, and I took a week off of work. And I basically let them know that I had a panic attack at my old branch where I used to work. They take stress leave very serious. So I just told them I was very stressed and that I was having anxiety over it. So they gave me a week off of work. And I stayed home with my sister and my mom. And this is where my life completely just changed. This is basically where I was at, like, my worst. I feel like it's kind of hard to explain it unless you've been there before, or you are somebody who deals with anxiety, or somebody who deals, you know, with panic attacks, because it's a feeling that I wouldn't wish upon my worst enemy. Like, I would never want anybody to feel the way that I felt at this point. And I just remember, like, me thinking that I was going crazy. Like, I felt like I was losing my mind. I felt like, I do think that the alcohol may have triggered it. And if you ever read, like, anybody that has anxiety or anything like that, they always say that alcohol is like a trigger for making situations like things like this worse, you know? I think that I did have anxiety at a point in my life before and I didn't know what it was. So then finally the alcohol might have made it just that much worse. That made me realize what it really was. So for the next couple of days, I'm not eating. I don't have an appetite. I'm just kind of like laying around in bed. I felt like conversations that I was having with people, with my sister, with my family, they weren't conversations. It was like I was speaking to them, but I was thinking about something else. Like, I would kind of like talk and I would daze off. It was like, I was just, my brain was just constantly, constantly working. And it was like working in a way that I was just so freaked out about, because your mind is a powerful thing. I feel like people, this is how people go crazy. And this is how, you know, things happen, like chemical imbalances and stuff. And this is how people start losing their mind. You know, traumatic things happen in your life that, causes things like this happening, you know. And I feel like it was all kind of all happening at once for me. You know, I moved out from my mom's house, and me being at home by myself every single day alone, having nobody to come home to besides, you know, Bianca, but she was doing her own thing and I was doing my own thing. It kind of brought everything together. You know, I felt like, they say that a lot of anxiety comes from college students when they first move out, stuff like that. So I felt like that was me, you know, moving out, experiencing something new, having alcohol involved, and everything that just kind of happened all happened to me at once. So they say anxiety comes from like traumatic experiences, blah 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 blah. But I was feeling like my life was, I don't know, it's just so weird to explain, but I honestly thought that I was going crazy. I thought that I was gonna like hear voices, and I was gonna like not, like I felt so bad. Like, it's just so, I can't even put into words how horrible I felt, you know, that I didn't want to eat, I didn't want to be at work. When I was at work, there was this one specific day that I ended up going back to work a week later, and there was a specific day that I was at work, and I just remember like crying, like I didn't want to be there, you know. And I was just on my computer and I was just sitting there, and I could hear everything around me. Like, I could hear people talking, I could hear the staplers, I could hear the computer typing, I could hear like dogs barking, I could hear everything. I felt like everything was silent and I could just hear the noises around me, and I felt like I wanted to just like run out and scream and run out and run as far and far far away as possible. And my sister also worked for the bank, so I email her and I'm like, dude, I'm freaking out. I was like, I don't know what's wrong with me. I was like, do you think I'm freaking losing my mind? Like, I'm scared. I don't know what to do. And my sister is very blunt, very just like, no, snap out of it. No, like, get over it. Like, she's very, very, very hard. Like, just, she thinks by building people with thick skin, that's what's gonna talk some sense into them. So she's like, Blanca, get it together. She was like, you're fine. Stop thinking about it. Stop worrying about it. Everything's gonna be okay. And I was just thinking like, I'm not okay though. Like, you don't know how I feel. Like, I felt like nobody in the world understood me at that point. I felt like nobody knew why I was feeling this way. And I started to just kind of slowly accept it. So before I decided to like understand what it was, I was freaking out because I wasn't eating. So this is where I lost a lot of weight. All the way down to like my very, very first video, this is when all of this was actually happening. And you will see in my face how much skinnier I was. And I was about 104 pounds at this point. I was really skinny. I was losing weight drastically. I went from like 120 to like 104 in like a period of 3 weeks. So that was very concerning to everybody around me. I was just losing weight. I wasn't eating. I couldn't eat. I had no appetite. And I told my doctor, I was like, this is what's happening. My hair is falling out. I'm just really stressed out. I don't know what's going on. So they did a whole bunch of tests on me to just make sure that I was okay. They like put me in a CT scan. They scanned my brain to make sure that I didn't have like a brain tumor or anything like that. Like they just did all the tests possible to eliminate anything serious, you know? And my doctor's just like, there's nothing wrong. It's just stress. So just try to take some time to just get your stuff together, you know? So when he knew that I was on like really stressed out, he took me out of work for 4 weeks. So people say that the doctor was like, I don't want you to be out of work for so long, because sometimes people with anxiety, getting them out of work makes the situation worse because they isolate themselves. So I need you to be talking to people, you know? So at this point, I'm like, the best decision for me to make is to just move back home and be with my family and be with the people that I know that are going to be there for me, because they're the only people that are going to make me feel better. So I left for 3 weeks from the Bay Area. I left Bianca by herself. Poor thing. Like, she was out there alone while I was trying to find myself and figure out what was going on. And it definitely made me feel better. But since that situation has happened, I have never been the same person again. Like, ever. I feel like I understand it now. I know what anxiety is. I know how it feels. I know how it makes me feel. I know how it affects my body, and I've learned to accept it. You know, there's times when like I feel a panic attack coming in, and I would just like be like, Blanca, you're fine. You survived the last one. You're gonna be okay. And I know how to accept it. I know what it does to me. I know how it feels. Like, people with anxiety, they have like vertigo. So my symptoms basically were like in vertigo. I felt very off balance. I would stand up and I felt like the floor was moving, or I felt like kind of like I was on a trampoline, like bouncing up and down. I also felt like my head was kind of in a cloud, like it's kind of like floating over me. So those are just some symptoms that I was experiencing: the weight loss, the panic attacks, the feeling of, you know, not being in control of the situation, and also like chest pains, then that all together. And what's crazy is because you feel it all at once. You feel that all just come at you like back to back to back to back, and you're just thinking like, I'm dying. I'm freaking dying, you know? So when that happened, I stopped drinking completely. I wasn't drinking for about, I want to say 2 years. And it's been probably about a year now that I've been drinking, but nothing like I used to drink. I get buzzed and feel drunk with like a sex on the beach or like 3 shots, you know what I mean? Like, the last time I got like intoxicatedly drunk where I was like, oh my god, I'm so drunk, it was probably my birthday, my 26th birthday. But for the most part, every time that I go out with my friends and then we go out and stuff, they can even tell you themselves, I drink, but I don't get drunk like I used to anymore. And I feel like I wanted to share this story with you guys because I feel like a lot of you guys think that because I promote it so much that I'm always drinking and I'm always drunk and I have an alcohol problem and blah, 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 blah. And I feel like I used to have an alcohol problem that completely changed my life now. Like, I feel like I drink it now, but it's because I just want to kind of feel a nice little buzz. But I don't drink to get drunk anymore. You get what I'm saying? And I feel like that's something that everybody should know. I feel like people need to learn their limits, because it took, you know, me going through this, whether I've been the alcohol or not, I always take it back to that day. To that day that I was so drunk and that I woke up with the worst hangover of my life. I always say that that day changed my life completely, because still to this day, I deal with anxiety. And my sister, every time I tell her, I'm like, oh my god, my anxiety, she's like, you don't have anxiety, shut up, you know? Like, you know it when you feel it. And I always tell her that. I'm like, girl, don't ever in your life wish or ever say that it does not exist, because until you start feeling this, you'll know what it's like to be in the position that I have been for the past, like, what, 5 years? Because I honestly feel like I'm a completely different person when it comes to life in general. I feel like it took me a long time. It took me about a year to deal with my anxiety, and it was probably the worst year of my life. I felt at my lowest. I felt so unmotivated. I felt like I wasn't gonna get through life in general with, you know, feeling like this. And it's such a crazy topic to feel, because I feel like after anxiety, if you don't deal with it, that's where like depression and, you know, people with suicidal thoughts, stuff like that comes in hand, like hand in hand, because it starts off as something and ends up after something else, you know. And, you know, us being Mexicanos and stuff, I know that I was never brought up to think that that's normal, you know, like you don't grow up here in America, everything is just like, oh, it's anxiety, it's anxiety, it's anxiety. And like in Mexico, it's not, like it's something more to them, you know. So now kind of getting a perspective of what it is and understanding it, it kind of makes you realize like, man, there's your life and things could just happen like this. You know, sometimes you wonder how people change overnight, or how a traumatic experience can make somebody completely lose their mind or whatever the case may be. But it happens, you know, it really does happen. And I'm fine with now where I'm at in life right now. I deal with it on a, you know, occasional basis. Before, it was kind of like I was dealing with it every single day. I would feel anxiety and anxious every single day for so long. And now I feel like I have my moments. There's times like where I'm just like dreading getting out of bed, and I'm just like, oh, like feeling anxious, or I know my trigger spots, like me going to the mall. I get really anxious being at the mall. And what's crazy, it's like, you know, my meet and greet that I did in Santa Ana when I had all those girls at the mall. Before all my girls came to meet me, I was having like legit panic attack, like right before. And at that moment, I was sitting there and I was like, oh my God. I was like, how am I going to do this? I was like, there's no way I'm going to be able to meet. There was 500 girls outside, you know. I was like, there's no way I'm going to be able to meet 500 girls, you know. And I just kind of sat there, drank some water. I gave myself some time. Like, they gave me a good like 15, 20 minutes to just get myself together, drink some water. And I was like, Blanca, you cannot let this be you. You get what I'm saying? So I feel like I have now learned to not let this take over my life. And I feel like people who are dealing with stuff like this, you need to get to the point where you're gonna say, you're gonna have your bad moments no matter what. Everybody has their bad moments. Everybody has those down moments. But you're gonna get to the point where you're gonna be like, this is not gonna be my life. You're not gonna let this take over you. You're not gonna let that bad day ruin the rest of your life or the rest of your days or whatever the case may be. So I put myself in that perspective, and I'm like, I'm not gonna not say hi to my girls who have been waiting here for 7 hours to meet me, all because I'm feeling vulnerable or anxious or whatever the case may be, you know. So I sucked it up and I was like, let's do it. So I was there for 3 hours. We went through all the girls and I put my good face on and I was like, let's do it, meeting them. And it was crazy because after like the third, fourth girl, I was like, okay, like I you guys made me just feel that much better, you know. I was just like, I'm fine, I'm okay. But I know my trigger spots. Like, I know that I can't be in places where there's a lot of people. I get really anxious, really overwhelmed when there's like a lot of people around me. Just stuff like that. But I feel like my life has changed now because I deal with it and I accept it. And I know that it's okay to feel the way that you feel. And, you know, I felt like I needed to just kind of let you guys know this story time. It went from like the alcohol to like my anxiety, but I had to put those two together. If you guys want me to make like a full video, like explaining to you guys how I like basically dealt with my anxiety, if any of you guys are basically like dealing with that or feeling like that, let me know, and I would totally do a whole video about it. I'm not ashamed of it. I'm not ashamed of saying that things like this do happen. But these two just kind of play together. But I always tell Miguel, like, you are the reason why I was never the same again. Like, I always blame him, but it's just all in a joking matter. But this is forever going to be, like, something that I always tell him, like, all because you wanted to bring Jaeger, you sent me to the emergency room. Like, sometimes I think about it, and I'm like, if I would have never drank that, like, would I have dealt with that? Would that have happened? But I think it would have. I feel like it was bound to happen. You know, it was bound to deal. Just kind of wanted to share with you guys this little story time. It was a little bit more personal and more like into depth about what happened or whatever the case may be. But yeah, I hope you guys all enjoyed this video. And thank you guys all so much for watching. And until next time, love you guys. I ain't worried about nothing. I ain't wearing a nada. I'm sitting pretty impatient.